So hello, Jackie. Thank you for joining us. So for those of you who are listening, Jackie is a lawyer. She is specialized in IT and in IT law and data protection. And she helps businesses with intellectual property, data protection, software, and other things related to the creative industry. I have asked her for an interview today because I know that we are all worried about GDPR regulations, especially, you know, how that translates into what we have on our websites, how we are collecting leads, and how we are growing our lists to work on our marketing. So I'm hoping Jackie can help enlighten us today.
Yes. Hi, good morning, Stephanie. Thank you for this opportunity to have a chat with you regarding GDPR. Because yes, I know that everybody's quite worried about it. At the moment, everyone's in a panic. So hopefully this chat will help to, you know, put people's minds at rest a little bit, and maybe they can sort of understand a little bit more what the requirements are.
Indeed. And in fact, one of the biggest worries, I think, is also that, you know, I've actually been looking around in online businesses, and there have been a lot of questions in the forums. And I mean, it's not just for the EU, it also goes a little bit beyond. So we're really looking forward to picking your brain today. So I think the first natural question is, you know, does this only affect people who have a business in the EU, or, you know, if I have a business in the US or outside of the EU, you know, if I have EU subscribers on my list, how is that going to affect me?
Yes, well, in fact, actually, this is one of the new concepts introduced by this new law. Essentially, the previous law, which also dealt, you know, with data protection quite extensively, but not to the extent that the new regulation has, only applied to businesses that were established within the EU. However, the scope of this new law, actually, as you are correctly saying, extends beyond that, because now it applies to you if you are established in the EU, so if you're doing business within the EU, meaning you have a base there, but also if you are established outside the EU, so if your business is in the US, for example, or in China or anywhere else in the world, but you provide services to customers within the EU, or even if you monitor behavior of people within the EU. So essentially, if you have a website, for example, that collects you know, IP addresses from people that are within the EU at that point in time, then you are basically subject to the GDPR even during that time.
Oh, so basically, if I have a US business and I'm collecting email addresses, and I have some clients that maybe have ended up on my list from the EU, then I have to follow GDPR regulations.
Yes, exactly. I mean, so I would say that basically everybody is pretty much subject to this because, like I said, even if you are just monitoring the behavior, so even if you have EU people who are, it doesn't even have to be EU citizens, they just have to be in the EU at that point in time. So if they're in Italy and they're browsing your website, you are basically subject to this regulation. And yes, of course, if you have email addresses that belong to people who live in the European Union, then again, you would be subject to, you know, to the GDPR for that purpose.
Wow, okay, amazing. So it's pretty much for everyone. Everybody needs to be aware of all the rules and you know, make sure that they are as compliant as possible. So let's try to understand sort of maybe how we can start to become compliant. I know it's a little bit late already because it comes into effect in May, so we're very late. But it's good to also know all the rules to be able to double check things. So if I already have a list, for instance, you know, maybe I had subscribers before, how do I now make that list GDPR compliant?
Okay, so you have to make sure that the list of people you have, if they have, for example, consented, let's say opted in to you sending them, let's say, a newsletter, right? Mm-hmm. You need to ensure that the consent, the opt-in that you obtained at that point in time was of a standard that complies with the GDPR. Now, the GDPR is essentially expanding very much what consent means. In other words, the requirements for obtaining a valid consent are much higher than they used to be. for instance, you have to provide much more information. You have to ensure that the information is very easy to understand.
Mm-hmm.
You have to literally give them information about every single little bit of data that you collect, what you do with that data, where it goes, how it is stored. So it is very hard for people to claim that they're going to be compliant, you know, with the previous sort of list of customers that they might have today. Of course, it is possible, but a lot of people, for example, have the practice of buying customer lists. Unfortunately, yes, that's not going to work very much anymore, because you need to ensure that, like I said, the consent that you have today is of a standard that is required by the GDPR. But if not, you actually have to refresh that consent. So in other words, that actually means getting in touch again with those people on your database and saying, look, you know, I mean, this new law, it requires that we are letting you know exactly what happens with our information. Please look at our privacy policy, which will give you all the information that you need. If you need any more information, please feel free to ask us. And if you don't actually tick this box, we will not send you any more information. Okay, so you actually need to get the opt-in again.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I mean by refreshing the consent. Just obtain that opt-in once more to ensure that you can actually show that you have obtained that consent in the proper way. The added issue with the GDPR is not only obtaining consent, but now you actually have to prove it. You have to, there's an accountability requirement, we call it, which means that essentially you don't only have to actually comply, but you have to show your compliance constantly. So if you had anybody, for instance, who complained, you know, and said, listen, I've received an email from this entity, I've never actually said I wanted to receive these emails, and you know, you actually did have some form of valid consent before, but you can't prove it, then you're still going to get into trouble. So essentially, very important to keep a trace, you know, an audit trail of how you got that consent, how it was obtained, so on and so forth. And therefore, what we are recommending is that, yes, as much as possible, do try to, you know, send out those emails again and get the opt-in once more.
Indeed, I believe that might be the biggest problem. Because sometimes, let's take myself as an example, and it, you know, sometimes your list grows, so you might migrate your tools, which means that you would have ended up, although you got them perhaps through a freebie and they knew they were going to receive the newsletter, now you cannot prove that you had that email where they knew they had the double opt-in, because you have shifted your list, so you don't have the track anymore. So shifting lists is going to become a little bit tricky. So in this case, I need to send that email again and get everybody.
Unfortunately, that is probably the best practice. You know, I mean, I know that a lot of people are concerned about this sort of activity, because yes, there is the risk that you will lose part of that customer database. But then on the other hand, you also know that, you know, the people who are receiving your newsletter or your marketing communications really do want to receive them. So really and truly, I mean, if you think about it, if you're sending, you know, all these emails to people who don't really want them, and how much of those actually translate into a customer. So, you know, you've got a higher chance of actually, you know, the email translating into an actual customer, if you do know for sure that, this is what they wanted. And if you're sending that email and if you're telling them, you know, we respect your privacy, we're compliant, we're very careful about what we do with your data, then you are much more likely to obtain the trust and the, you know, desire of that customer to actually contract with you. So, you know, looking at it a little bit from the point of view of trying to see this as an opportunity rather than a problem, I think that's a mind shift that we will need to make at this stage.
Indeed. In fact, it's something I totally agree with, because like you said, you're going to have much higher conversion rates of email list to clients if people really want to receive your content. And I think by sending it to people who don't want it, you're damaging your reputation.
That's right.
In terms of marketing, it's it is a step in the right direction. And it is, as an end user, very annoying to receive emails all the time from people who just want to prospect, who just want to sell you stuff. You know, that so it is going to hopefully reduce the volume in our inbox by quite a bit.
Yeah, so it's more about sort of quality rather than quantity, I think. You know, that is the way one needs to look at it. So it's the quality customers that you want, the ones that are actually going to be, you know, using your service rather than just receiving your emails and maybe thinking this is a nuisance, you know. So I think yes, if it were me, I, as a customer, I think I would probably think, okay, you know, these people are getting in touch. They're actually letting me know what they're doing with my data, and I think that would make me feel more confident in actually buying a service or a product from them.
Indeed, it helps with trust.
That's right.
So just to clarify a little bit, because different tools maybe have different features. So your proof that they are GDPR compliant, after you have sent them maybe the email, like we just mentioned, that they are now going to give you GDPR compliant approval. So what do I need to keep as proof? Do I need to keep the email? Do I need to keep the form that I actually maybe sent?
Well, essentially, what you need to keep in mind is something that could be proven in court, for instance, you know, if there had to be an issue. So yes, I mean, if you have any way, you can do this even through technological. So if you have a way of recording, you know, that consent in your systems, yes, that is a valid consent. I mean, there are systems which actually, you know, can drill it down to the place where you were, you know, the actual minute that you sort of ticked that box. So there are various ways that this can be done. I mean, obviously, depending on the situation and if you're you know, sort of meeting the person face to face, then I mean you would require something signed by them. But I think sort of if it's through a website or you know, a digital platform, it is actually easier probably to have that level of proof that would be required. So essentially this the consent needs to translate within your systems into a place where, you know, all of these records are being held.
Excellent. The best thing would be to actually ask, I imagine, your email provider, you know, what kind of data would be GDPR compliant. I do intend to do a bit of a technical workshop to get into this. So I will be showing it at least in one package to help people understand how it's actually going to happen.
How is it? Because see, the difficulty with this new regulation, I think, is actually trying to visualize how all of this new regulation translates in practice. But when you actually see it happening in front of you, you know, when you actually see what really happens and how simple it is in effect to become compliant, especially technologically, then, you know, the complexity kind of, it doesn't remain so terrifying.
It's true, indeed. In fact, if the tool you're using has everything you need, and there are many free tools out there, then you're
right.
Fine. As long
That's
as you follow the simple processes, which we have already outlined. And, you know, another thing that maybe might worry people is, you know, if somebody has registered for a freebie before, but I didn't have that tick box that said you will also receive a newsletter. And perhaps I have been sending them a newsletter already, but they haven't unregistered. Does that mean that they kind of have complied to receive the newsletter, or do I still need to get formal approval?
No, I would say, to be safe, you should get the formal approval. I mean, it's okay to incentivize that. Often, you know, you can tell people, look, if you do opt in again, we are giving you, for example, a 10% discount on our product, so on and so forth. But the two things you need to keep in mind for that are, first of all, you need to ensure that they can withdraw at any point in time. So if they've subscribed, they can unsubscribe in as easy a manner as it took to subscribe originally. But you also have to make sure that even once they have received the discount or the offer or whatever it is, you know, you're not saying, hey, you've now unsubscribed and I'm going to take that back. You know, so whatever you've offered as an incentive, you need to basically continue to provide, even if they have withdrawn their consent at a later stage. And secondly, you cannot tie the offering of the service to the receipt of that opt-in. So in other words, you shouldn't say, you know, yes, please opt in, but then you can't actually go onto the service or go on to register unless you have opted in. So that's not free consent, you see, that's not freely given. So yes, you can tie the offer to the opt-in, but not the service. You cannot say, you can't say, I mean, if you want to buy tickets from our site, you have to opt in. That's not possible. What you can say is you can opt in and get 10% on your first ticket, but that's as far as it can go. You know, you cannot prevent the service because they haven't opted in.
Indeed. And it makes sense as well, because the more I learn about it, actually, the more I think it makes perfect sense. Another thing that perhaps people might do sort of in their marketing campaigns is maybe, you know, they run webinars, they have campaigns, and sometimes you might collect the email list in your webinar tool or maybe inside a website plugin, and then you migrate that to your main list. How is that going need to happen now? How does it need to happen? Okay, we understood that we were going to need to send them GDPR compliance for now, so for the new list to become compliant. Yeah. But how should we do it from now on? Can we still do that?
Okay. Well, what you do need to do is it needs to be what we say granular. Okay, at this point, so you let's say you're saying, okay, if you're you know, please sign up for this webinar. So you're taking the email address and so on. That needs to be, so the actual signing up for the webinar should be separate to the other tick box, which says, and from now on, we'd also like to receive information about the next seminars or podcasts that you're providing. So you need to separate the offering of the service from the actual receipt of marketing emails. So you cannot make one depend on the other. You cannot say, if you don't opt into the marketing email, then I won't provide the webinar, so on and so forth. So in other words, the way to be to, yes, say, look, you need to sign up, give us your email address, please, for us to be able to contact you and give you details, you know, of how to log in for this webinar. And then if you also want to receive additional information from us, please tick this additional box.
Excellent. Okay, so we need to make sure that they know exactly how their emails will be used. And of course, we have to tell them if they're going to receive a newsletter or if they're just going to be informed about maybe the new webinars. So they would need to specifically receive the information we've told them they will. We cannot just send newsletters. If they want to receive,
so you cannot. I mean, you cannot. It needs to be a little bit more explained. You know, you need to get consent for the actual processing that you are going to be doing. So, if you are intending to send, sort of information about 100 products that you might have, you can't say, look, I'm just going to give you information about this one and then send, you know, information about 100. I mean, it just needs to be a little bit more, clear. And upfront, what you're planning to do with that email address.
Excellent. So basically, it's a call for transparency. You've got to do what you say you're going to do, or else you've got to let them know before. And, you know, it's positive relationship building. I believe it's a good code of ethics to have.
That is exactly right, in fact. You know, there is the possibility if a data subject or person, for one of your services, then it is what we call a legitimate interest to send them information about a similar service that you are also providing, as long as they had originally opted into the first service and you're always giving them the option to opt out at any point in time. At any point in time they want to opt out, that needs to be respected. So it would be absolutely terrible if somebody's opted out and then, you know, they've received that. So that is a clear breach of the law.
Excellent. Okay, wow. And like you mentioned before, obviously unregistering needs to be easy. And is there Does it have to be automated? Because I believe giving the user self-service, they need to be able to do it themselves. Does that mean it needs to be an automated IT service to unregister?
Yes, what the law says is that it needs to be as easy to withdraw the consent as it is to give it. So ways of doing it would be, provide a link and that you send, the next copy of the newsletter that you send. You can provide a link there, so if you want to unsubscribe, click here and make it easy, don't require them to click 20 times, for them to be able to get to that point where they can unsubscribe. Or for instance, require detailed information as to why they're unsubscribing. So it needs to be easy. It shouldn't put people off. It shouldn't be that difficult to unsubscribe that people give up, So it does need to be easy to do. If you've done it online, if you've originally subscribed online, then ideally, yes, you should be able to unsubscribe online. If, for instance, one way of doing it is through a website, you've got, let's say, an options page, where you can actually tick and all the different, for example, cookies are shown there and all the different scripts that are collecting information, and one of them is your email marketing permission. So, some of our clients have done that, you stick the box there and then save your preferences. And then, at a later stage, if you want to change your preferences again, just basically go onto that options button, change the preferences again and press save. So, an easy automated way of doing it is ideal, yes.
Excellent. Very good. So that is, I think it's really pretty much very sort of clear in terms of processes. So
I think that the law is quite, sort of logical, really. I mean, if you think about it and you think in terms of not as the marketer, but as the recipient of these marketing emails or the data subject, if you put yourself in those shoes, what would you like to be done with your data? How much information would you like to have? What sort of emails do you want to be receiving? And do you want to be receiving stuff that you're not interested in? Applying that to the other side of the picture, so to the marketer. So think in terms of what yourself as a consumer would like to receive, how you would like your data to be protected. And that should give you pretty much the answer most of the time. I think that is, just a basic rule of thumb that I like to apply. It's pretty logical. It does go a little bit far in the sense that, yes, it does require a lot of detailed information, especially what's required to be disclosed in privacy notices, so on and so forth. Yes, there are heavier requirements, but, pretty much I think if you think about it from a fairness and transparency point of view, You get there, you can get there quite easily.
That's great. Yes, I totally agree. Now, the one thing that obviously people might worry a bit about, and they would probably need some professional help with this as well, is, what is now going to go in my privacy notice and in my terms and conditions? We know that obviously we need to put a lot more information to be transparent. So what are the basics and how can we begin? Because every business is different. Where do we start?
Well, basically, again, always keeping the transparency in mind, right? You definitely need to tell, tell the person or put in your privacy notice who you are, right? So that's where you start from. We've seen privacy notices that don't explain, they just say, this is what we do, but who's we, really? We needs to be explained. So you need to tell the people who you are. You need to tell the individual, this is how to contact us if you have any issues. If you've appointed actually, a person like a data protection officer to take care of these issues, then you should also put that person's contact details. So that is a little bit about you, about the data controller. What you then need to explain is what data you collect. So for instance, if you are monitoring people's behavior on your website, you need to tell them that. You need to tell them what type of monitoring you carry out. Ideally, you would even explain sort of the kind of cookies or the kind of scripts that you use to do that. You should also explain, for instance, the categories, different categories of data that you are collecting. So, if it's data relating to your behavior on the website, that's one category. If it's data relating to email marketing, that's another category. Mm-hmm. If it's data relating to opening an account with you, then that's another category. So just, sort of drill them down, try to find exactly what data you are collecting. And then you have to give it a reason. So for each bit of data that you're collecting, just explain why. What is the reason that I'm monitoring you on the website, for example? It's because I want to understand your behavior. I want to understand what interests you. And that way I can then send you, advertising or other articles that are actually in tune with your interests rather than just sending them randomly, So just a little bit of an explanation. Why am I collecting this data? And then what I do with it, So if you're storing it on your servers, if you're storing it with a third party, if you're actually sending it outside of the European Union, which then that would require additional safeguards, and explain a little bit about your security, so on and so forth. You also need to very clearly explain the rights that the data subject has. So that's pretty much standard text there, but there are 8 basically rights data subjects have, one of which, for instance, would be the right to access their data. So they need to know what data they collect about you. And so it's not just a matter of saying, this is what we collect. It's also a matter of saying, if you want to get in touch with us and want to ask us what data we collect, please click here, for instance, So you're making it easy for them to know exactly what data you're collecting, what you're doing with that data, why you are collecting it, and essentially how it is being safeguarded and what rights you have in that respect. Okay, so that pretty much, I think, would sum it up. If you happen to be in a situation where you're receiving data, but not directly from the individual, then in that case, you would also need to explain the source of that data. So if you're obtaining that data because you are, obtaining it from a third party for some reason or through some contract, then you would also need to explain that. So when we're talking about privacy notices, we're not just talking privacy notice on the website. Privacy notice now has become something that you provide in any aspect of a business, so to your employees, so on and so forth.
Excellent. And of course, if people need help with the privacy notice and with the terms and conditions, because they are kind of the legal side, the way we see it is kind of the legal side of the business, can people actually get in touch with you to get their terms and conditions reviewed?
Sure.
Professional help.
Sure, no problem. We do this sort of all the time, for numerous clients at this point. So in each case, we try to, as much as possible, put the notices into very simple rather than legal language, because they have to be easily understood by anybody. Mm-hmm. So the average person, reading this policy should be able to understand it. And somehow there's also a requirement for, even at law, for despite all of this information, it needs to be, a very, very short notice. So somehow we try to translate all of this into a few pages, a few clauses, So yes, I mean, sure, we're happy to help anybody who's in need. The other thing I did want to mention, Steph, is that it's not just a privacy notice. Now, unfortunately, because there is this requirement of accountability, everybody needs to have internal policies as well.
Okay.
So it's, a policy, for example, about how you deal with data generally, internally, a policy about how long you keep that data, a policy about how you store it and what security measures you have in place. So all of this needs to be actually kept. You need to have these policies, and they have to be kept somewhere where they're easily accessible and given to your supervisory authority in the case there's ever an issue. Now, of course, depending on the type of organization, because if you're in an individual with a few clients and you're basically servicing them on that level, it's a detailed amount of policies that a huge corporation would have if they're sending data to their sort of different branches abroad and so on. But a level of sort of accountability needs to be there. Okay, so it's not just the proof of the consent and so on, it's also having the policies there to begin with, you know. So if you're ever investigated, you need to be able to show that, look, we do have policies, we actually sat down and thought about this and put it down on paper, you know, the way we treat people's data. So I think in a nutshell, that's what it boils down to.
Excellent. And that's something you can help companies do
as
well?
Yes, we can help. I'm helping with that too.
Excellent. That's great. So I will be adding the link to get in touch with you under the video and also in the article that will accompany the video later for people who prefer to read the information and maybe absorb it a little bit more slowly.
Yeah.
It is a lot to absorb.
It is.
That's great. Thank you so much, Jackie. Thank you so much for answering all our questions.
And I
urge everyone to, you know, look out also for the next video, which will have the technical details, and especially for the article that will accompany everything, so that, you know, we'll try and put in a clear checklist of everything we talked about, so that you can have a clear path of where to start and where to end. And then if you need additional help, I'm also going to add Jackie's link so that you can get in touch with her, you know, if you need a professional lawyer's help. So thank you very much for being with us, Jackie.
Thank you very much, Stephanie. Good day. Thank you.
Bye.